Please join me in welcoming Jesse Shaw.
Sure. Yeah, I think it's... Hello. So I want to thank Penny Lutz for and the committee for inviting me here to campus to show my work. It's been very honored to be here and be able to talk about my work. So a couple things that I want to talk about at the beginning is why I make this work, right? Hey, why I make this work, how did this work start? Answer a few of the questions that I get often when I talk about this work. Am I good on levels here? Can you hear me okay? All right. So as a young art student, I took many different classes, right? When you go in to get your Bachelor of Fine Arts and you're taking academic classes in art, you start with your drawing, foundation classes, you take ceramics, you take sculpture, you take many of the different mediums. And when I had my first printmaking class and I did my first simple linoleum cut, which is basically where you carve into a soft piece of material, it's made out of cork, and then you basically make a stamp of that of the material. And right when I made that first stamp, that first impression, that first print, I knew right then and there, like, this is it. This is what I've been searching for. This suits my vision, the way that I want to make work. And I didn't know what it was up to that point because, you know, I grew up in a military family. We moved all over. I didn't pursue art right out of high school. I took a lot of every kind of class. You know, I didn't know what I wanted to do. It wasn't until I was about 24 when I took my first art class. And then I felt at home in that department, took a printmaking class, felt at home with the medium. So ever since then, I've been pulling prints. I graduated in 2007 from Austin Peay, small school in Clarksville, Tennessee, which is a military town. My dad was in the Army and he retired at Fort Campbell. And then right after I graduated there, I went to Rhode Island School of Design and pursued my master's. And it was at Rhode Island School of Design that I started this body of work. So I'd always had an interest in political work, social commentary, satire. I like work it's serious, but it's also, you know, kind of funny at the same time. And at the time I was making small broadside prints, which is where you have a strong punchy image accompanied with some text. And I never thought about taking it and creating a whole world out of that kind of those kind of things. Until one of my professors said that I should go to Dartmouth, go to their library, and check out the mural by Jose Clemente Orozco called The Epic of American Civilization. When I spent 3 or 4 hours driving there, I spent about 3 hours with the painting, walking around, reading about it, just soaking in all the imagery. And I wanted to do that, but in print. So I wanted to approach printmaking like a Mexican muralist, you know, like Orozco, like Siqueiros, Rivera. So that's where it began. And during my time at RISD, I was also fortunate enough to get to go to Mexico and study in Mexico. So I went to Oaxaca, I stayed in Cuernavaca, and we went to Mexico City. So we got to study all the murals from all the masters, went to Frida Kahlo's house, went to see all the prints, you know, different print shops. So it really opened up my eyes. So your student here, I highly recommend you do a study abroad. It just makes you a totally different person. So it's always a good thing to do. So I did my first print, which is actually, it's one of the ones that's right behind us here. You can just take a quick glance. This one right here, when you get a chance to make your way around, this was the first print in the series, Arrival of the White Man. And that's a print that's based off of Rhode Island's seal, their city seal for Providence. It's a picture of Roger Williams stepping off the boat and greeting the Narragansett Indians, and it says, "What cheer?" Question mark. No, it says, "What cheer?" Exclamation point. Right? And so it was that image that I was like, that's where my story needs to start. It needs to start with that footprint. And that's the way the work progressed for a while, because I didn't know what kind of story I wanted to tell. I just know I wanted to do 50 images. I wanted to pick something so far out in the future that I know that I would be a different person when I got to the end of it, you know? So that's how the work went. It went very didactic, like this happened. And, you know, These two have to be put side by side because they're based on a series of prints. The idea is based on a series of prints called Christ and Antichrist, where it shows it was done by Lucas Cranach. He was a good friend of Martin Luther during the Reformation. And he did a series of books which showed the Pope, and then it showed the life of Jesus, and then it compared those two together, right? So we have like the white man arriving of his own volition, and the African man arriving against his will under, you know, horrific circumstances. So it has to have those two together. All the other ones, I like them to be put up in any order. They can all go in any order, but those two have to be next to each other. Just the different standard. So everything in the work was very didactic. American epic, it's a story of American civilization. But if there was a point where I realized there's none of me in this work at all. This is just this happened. That's not interesting, you know. And it took a while to get there. And then the turning point was one of these prints here. This is where I think I turned a corner. Started putting myself in the work. I grew up in the South, right? You know, Southern Baptist. Some of my best friends were, their parents were preachers. And we'd have conversations like, well, hypothetically, what if this, this, and this? Are you going to heaven? And it seemed like the answer was always, no, you're going to hell. There's no wiggle room there, you know? It's like, oh, what if you never heard of anything? You were born in a remote place and never got baptized. Then what? Yeah, still, same thing. You know, it was very, very, you're either with us or you're against us kind of thing with Southern Baptist religion. So, you know, I took that imagery, and these are churches from all the town that I lived in, and I just made that simple image. You're either with us or you're against us. Check or X, you know? And from this print, then I started to put more of myself into the work and started to pull more from my own personal experiences, my own point of view, things that I experiences that I've had, and the work has really grown since then. Then I started to develop my set of visual language, certain icons that mean something to me and that actually start to pick up meaning in the work. Because everything up here that you see, it's not just pulled out of thin air or completely at random. It's all coming from a place, whether it's something I heard or something I seen or something that an artist that I looked at. It's all coming from some kind of a real experience. And so I guess I'll talk about the way I build a print, typically, the way I make a print. And typically it starts with me having a little bit of an idea of what I want to talk about in the work, an interest. Like, for example, this one right here, I was interested in technology. There was a story on the news where this woman, she'd been shot in the face with a shotgun, and she got the first face transplant. And that just blew my mind. I didn't, you know, never heard of that. You know, that's like sounds something so futuristic. So it made me want to know more about the technology advances in just surgery. So I've come to find out some of the first, you know, the first heart transplant was done. And when that was, when that first that happened, there was people that were against that during that time. That sounds like something very pedestrian, getting a heart transplant. Well, not totally pedestrian, pretty major surgery, right? But still, it's not like, oh, you had a heart transplant. It's not that big a deal. But when these were first done, it was a big deal. People thought your soul resided in your heart. And if you gave your heart to somebody, that means you were going to be stuck in some kind of limbo forever, right? So when I have an idea, I just started with this. I knew I wanted to put her face in there, and then I jumped over here, and I know I wanted this. So the way that I work is I have a big piece of linoleum. Like I said, that cork material. It's the same stuff that they make flooring material out of, except for it's not pressed or stamped or printed. It's just a cheap, humble material, right? And then I'll draw on the material, and I'll start carving. And it'll take me, you know, I'll spend 5-6 hours carving, you know, in a session. And over that time, I have tons of free time for my mind just to wander and to think about where I want to go next with the print. And as she mentioned, it takes me about an average 5, 6, 7, 8 months, 9 months, 10 months sometimes to make one of these images. And I don't have a proper studio. I mean, I do now. I'm lucky now. I have a studio. But at the time, most of this work, I didn't have a studio. Most of these are printed with a wooden spoon. But let me back up. So I make a drawing, right? I carve. And then over that time frame, I'm walking past it all day, every day. If I'm sitting on the couch watching TV, I can see my workspace. So it's kind of like, you know, feel a little guilty, and I can, but I'm always constantly thinking about it. So when I have an idea and somebody says something, oh, you should check out this, or you should check out that, I'm like writing it down, I check it out, and then it goes into the work. So it's kind of like my baby for that amount of time, and then I move past it, you know, like, so now I'm interested in something else, and I use the work as a way to learn more about things, you know, where you can be a little bit of a quasi expert in a short, brief amount of time. And then, I don't know, it all seems to go in one ear and out the other, you know, as far as like some of these things. But anyways, so the material's carved, and then at the end, I roll ink on top of the plate, and then I put the paper on top, and then I use a wooden spoon, and I make small circles about the size of a dime, and I go over the entire thing from the other side of the print, right? And that pulls the ink off the print. So essentially, all these are stamps. And the reason why I do it this way, and like what I like about the medium, is because it's so archaic. It's like the most archaic and direct way of making multiples. And there's like a power in making multiples. Like this show right now can exist in many different places and all be considered the real thing, right? Because these are all real prints. And another reason I like about the work is I like the black ink on white paper. There's a certain amount of authority that comes along with just something that's printed stamped. Like if you were to take somebody's loan application and you write declined in a pencil, you know, it doesn't mean the same thing as if you write, boom, declined with a big stamp, right? There's a certain amount of authority that comes behind like the printed image that way. And that's another thing I like about that and why they're black and white and why they're not in color. I just want to keep it just positive, negative space. So that's another thing that draws me to the medium. And as far as the imagery, you know, like I said, everything was very didactic. You know, matter of fact, this happened, this happened, this happened. And then I started to develop my own narratives within the stories. And those come from some of my own personal, you know, stories growing up. Like you'll notice if you walk around, you see a lot of chickens in the work. There's chickens all over the place in the work. It's because that the chicken, it serves as my underdog to the overall story. And the reason why is when I was in middle school, high school, you know, we used to ride on the bus. You know, I lived in a rural area, so we had to drive 20 minutes to get to school. And we would go past this chicken factory. It was an egg plant, actually. It made, you know, they produced eggs. So they had millions and millions of chickens in there. But you could smell it from like 10 miles away. And we used to ride past it all the time. And my friend's mother worked there. She didn't work in the plant part. She worked as far as cleaning offices at night. So one night when I was spending the night with him at his house, she took us over there because she had to clean one of the offices, and we got to take a tour of the chicken coop. You know, it's not really a chicken factory, but a slaughterhouse, whatever you want to call it. And we got to see where they processed all the eggs. So some of the eggs would fall on the ground, and then those would get swept into a vat in the middle of the floor, and that vat would be sent to make dog food or something, you know, something like that. All the eggs that got broken on the assembly line would be put in these big blue containers. So it'd be full of egg yolks, broken shells, stuff that didn't hit the ground. Those would go to make Twinkies, Hostess. And we got to see the part where they had all the chickens. So when they opened up the doors, and you ever seen that Raiders of the Lost Ark where there's all those boxes at the end and they go to a vanishing point and it's just infinite amount of information? It was like that, but with chickens. They were seven stacked tall and in cages all the way back as far as you could see, but it was the sound and hearing them all at the same time. It was just like, that's the most apocalyptic, you know, just horrible thing, like the noise. So it was the noise that really made me think, oh, this is the animal, this is the underdog. They're gonna try, but they're never gonna win, but they're gonna keep prevailing. So, you know, so I use them a lot in the work. The bird, it serves as the narrator that goes through the story. It starts on the very first where Columbia, which is a character from Thomas Nast, his prints, and everybody's seen a Thomas Nast print. So I look to history too with a lot of my work. Thomas Nast is most famous for the reason why we have Republicans as the elephants, Democrats as donkeys. He created that iconography. He also created the way we think of Santa Claus. And he also created this other character called Columbia. And she shows up in the work quite a bit, right here. She serves as like the conscience, you know, the human conscience of the work. So I looked at history, I looked at my own personal experiences, I looked at documentaries, I looked at the music, I looked to many places for inspiration. So I guess right now, well, let's maybe carry over to the other side of the room, and I'll just talk about one of the prints over there and talk about like how I made it. So I like using a lot of allegory. I like using a lot of humor in the storytelling and the work. And this is a good one to talk about because it has a lot of information about myself in this work. And it allowed me to kind of talk more about who I am and where I'm coming from in this print. So I know I have a daughter. She's 14 now. But at the time when I made this print, I think she was about 6 or 7. And she had little owls, cutesy owls, on everything that she owned, right? Pajamas, toys, these little cute owls. And I remember one day I said to her, man, owls are not cute at all. They're pretty gross. And I was like, let me show you something. And I pulled up on YouTube an owl throwing up an owl pellet, you know? Because that's what they do. They eat mice, and then they'll throw it up, and then those little pellets will get sent off to high schools all over the country, and you dissect them, and then you put the... Has anybody else ever done that? Or I go someplace really weird? So I wanted to... Whoa. Did I just get way louder all of a sudden? Okay. So I wanted to... So I wrote that down. Owls are gross. Owls are gross. I think I'm getting too close here. And then, so I built this print around that. Owls are gross. So I have this owl. He's getting squeezed. The owl pellet. But then this one is just slowly getting away. That near miss. You know, when you almost have an accident, and you're like, oh my God, I almost died just then. You know? And then you're like, so I wanted to have that. I also was thinking back to when I grew up in Hawaii. My dad was in the military, as I said. We moved all over. I went to Pearl Harbor Elementary School. And as going to an elementary school in Hawaii was quite diverse, right? So we didn't go to like our own separate schools. We went to public schools. So one of the very few white kids to school. And they call white people there howlies. Howlies. And local population, they don't really, well, military encroaches a lot on the culture there. And I got to see that growing up. And I was thinking about some of the things we used to do when I was a kid there. And one of the things we do is we would collect these land snails. They have an invasive species there called, it's just a giant land snail. And it grows to about the size of your hand. And people would basically get them as pets, exotic pets, they let them go. But they multiply rapidly, and they thrive in a place like Hawaii. And they also have them in Texas, and they have them in Florida, too. We used to collect them, and we would put them in buckets and watch them writhe over each other. You know, like I said, these animals weren't supposed to be there in Hawaii. And also, I remember a time when I was there where we would go fishing at night. And one night, we went out there, and there was some GIs. There's about 5 GIs drinking, you know, raising hell. You know, being what young GI military guys do. And they were taking a boat about 2 miles out to sea and dropping a line, and they were shark fishing. And you're not supposed to do that, right? And also, like, growing up and learning about Hawaiian culture, they treat tiger sharks and sharks, they're deity animals. They carry, like, the souls of ancestors. You know, they're to be revered, respected, not to be fished like a common whatever, like, you know. They were taking this line about 2 miles out to sea, and me and my friends, we were fishing just for whatever was around the pier, and they caught a shark, and it took all 5 of them working together. There was a guy sitting on a small, like, half of a barrel. He was crouched down with the reel, and he was reeling back and forth like this. There was a guy pouring water onto the reel because it was like the friction was almost like setting it on fire, like melting it, because the shark would pull out. They'd bring it in. And there's a couple other guys, you know, working to pull the pole and then release tension, pull the pole, reel it in, pull tension. So it took all of them working together. They pull the shark up onto the pier. 2 guys grab, one grabs a baseball bat, one grabs a crowbar, and they hit the tiger shark over the head, knock it unconscious, and they string it up. They gutted it, cleaned it, divided the meat against them, amongst themselves, right then and there, right? And, you know, I was like 8 years old, so I was just like, I didn't know what I was seeing. So those things kind of stuck with me, like, you know, just those 2 images. And then I thought about it, you know, like, how do I incorporate that into the work? from my own experience, you know, growing up in Hawaii. So, you know, these land snails that aren't supposed to be there, these invasive species, you know, very much like the way that sometimes the military takes advantage of the culture in Hawaii, based on my limited experience there. And then them working all together to capture this, you know, magnificent animal, right? So that, and so when I have this kind of imagery, I have this, I start carving this, and I figure the rest of it out along the way, right? But they all kind of pull from those kind of memories, those kind of things. And whenever I have an idea, and if it can be something so absurd, you know, I'll write it down, and I'm like, that's going to be a print, you know. So that's how it just keeps on going, on and on and on, until I get to the finished prints, the 50. Oh, that leads me to another thing. Like, so let's say I'm working on a print, and I'm approaching the whole series this way too. And every time I'm working on a print, there's a point where I have this and this done, and I'm like, I'm looking at the work, and I'm like, this is a terrible idea. You know, there's always a time where I doubt and I think that it's a failing thing. And then whenever that happens, then I have to resolve it. I have to figure out some kind of conclusion to wrap up the work, something to kind of put it all together. And I think that's kind of the way I've been approaching the work. And when I get to the end, like, how do I put a final, this is the end of the story? You know, it's going to be a tough thing to make that call. So it's like, right now I'm in that point where, like, oh, this is a terrible idea. I don't know how it's going to go. But when I get there, I think I'll figure that out. Like, how to resolve this story? Where does it end?